So these lectures will be about will be an introduction to the Einstein equations, and specifically, I'm going to look at Cauchy, the Cauchy problem for the Einstein equations in presence of matter. So the main focus, or at least the first motivation, is to understand the coupling between matter and geometry through the Einstein equations. And that's especially if I find the missing box. This is what we will go through now. So you don't need to understand what these symbols mean for the time being. But we have matter. The matter is self-gravitating. You express the evolution of the matter by the Einstein equations. And in some way, you would like to solve the initial value problem for these equations. And you will see in a minute how this is formulated. So the first talk today and the first 2 hours will be introductory. They may go too fast for some people. They probably will go too slow for other people. But in any case, you will see with the next lectures that we will revisit some of this material a couple of times. So you should not be afraid if you don't understand everything immediately. I will distribute the notes, but eventually I will put them in my blog. So you will find them in my blog in 2 or 3 weeks probably. But in a meantime, what I suggest is that you send me an email to this address. So just contact at my name. .org. And so if you send me an email, even this evening, I will send you the file of the notes that I show on the screen. So what we will do is, for some specific problem, because this is really a broad, very broad area, we will look at the global dynamics of matter for specific matter content that I will explain. And we will ask some questions about what is the global geometry of the space-time, which is generated by this self-interacting matter. So this is the address of my blog where you will eventually see the PDF file of these notes. So today I will simply introduce the equations, say some generalities, and importantly, I will show the various matter models that we will be interested in. And then there will be 3 main results in this course. So again, this is really a broad field, so I had to make choices. And there will be 3 main results. The first one will be actually in the vacuum, but this is very much connected to the matter still. So it will be the class of spacetimes with so-called T2 symmetry in a vacuum. And the interesting part of that story is that the spacetime will be weakly regular, so they will allow singularities. The curvature will not be defined in a standard way. The curvature will be a distribution. And in particular, that's a way to allow gravitational waves, impulsive gravitational waves, to propagate in the spacetime. So this will be the first class of spaces that we will study. Then we will look at matter spacetimes. Again, the weak regularity will be only assumed. The curvature will be a distribution. And we will be assuming spherical symmetry, and shocks can propagate in these spacetimes. And the third result will be the stability of the Minkowski spacetime, which of course is a most simplest example of spacetime satisfying the Einstein equations. So we will look at that, stability of Minkowski spacetime, when a small perturbation is put initially on some hypersurface, and this perturbation disperses, and you want to somehow recover the geometry of Minkowski space asymptotically in time. And this is something we will do in the case of self-gravitating massive fields. And all the methods that existed so far were concerned with a vacuum case or with a non-massive, massless scalar field. This story is also very much connected, this last topic, with the Einstein-Klein-Gordon equation, the theory of modified gravity. And this will be something I'm going to explain today. right? Matter, spacetime, Euler equations, compressible fluids, Einstein, Klein, Gordon, modified gravity. Okay, so these are the keywords that I want to present today. The focus here is really on the techniques of analysis, right? So I do some geometry, I look at the global geometry of the space-time that I construct, but somewhere in the middle of that, there is the analysis part, the PDEs that you have to analyze, and you have to do this analysis with a robust argument in order to cover the broad classes of space-time that I want to cover. So every result will be either with matter, I mean most of them will be with matter, and if not, in any case it will be by allowing solutions to be weak, to be defined in a sense of distributions. There will be a selection of results, as I explained, with rather full proofs, except that I may go a little bit fast for some of these results, but you should really go through the details that will be available in the notes. And there will be also some more advanced statements that I will mention in the end of the chapters. Okay, so we start with an introduction to matter models. And the way that this is structured, this chapter is structured, is that we will start by writing the field equations of general relativity, so meaning the Einstein equations for the geometry, plus the Euler equations to describe the evolution of the matter. And I will show you how the initial value problem is formulated. And in a second part, the theory of modified gravity will be introduced. And so you don't need to know the theory of classical gravity. Somehow, in a whole, I will tell you about classical gravity, modified gravity. And my goal here is to present a situation where you have a matter effect that comes in a rather natural way in the problem. So it's not so much, I'm not so much motivated by modified gravity from a physical perspective. This model is probably, you know, just a variant of the Einstein equations, but I'm interested in this model as a way to, as you will see, to lead to an interesting mathematical structure, which is the Einstein-Klein-Gordon system. Right. So you will see in a few minutes that the theory of modified gravity is a way to actually introduce some matter, some coupling between the geometry and the matter in a certain way that may seem more natural than introducing the matter directly in itself. To study this equation of modified gravity, you have, I mean, everywhere you have to introduce coordinates, right? So this is really something in this field that you are given a problem which is geometric and you want to do some analysis, right? So you have to go from the geometrical formulation to the PDE formulation where you can introduce Sobolev spaces and compactness argument and so on. And this will be done in, at least for this chapter, by introducing what is called a wave gauge. So the coordinates must satisfy the wave equations, as I will explain. Okay, so this is the beginning of the story. You have a four-dimensional manifold. This manifold is endowed with a metric, which is Lorentzian. So the signature, rather than being Riemannian with only plus signs, it has a negative sign corresponding to the time direction, if you like. And on this manifold, we have vectors, tangent vectors to the manifold. At any point of the manifold, and we can look at the norm of it, right? So since the signature is not positive, it has a negative sign, when you compute the norm gxx of a vector, you may end up with something negative, zero, or positive, and you will say, and I guess the picture that you have to have in mind for instance, the cone in Minkowski space would be to plot vectors, three vectors in this way, so you could be inside this null cone and being timelike in the future direction or in the past direction, or you can have a vector which is null or so past or future of past direction, a null vector if it is tangent to this picture, or a spacelike vector. Right. So you have this basic geometry, and you will learn about that as we go along. So there is a time orientation that will be always assumed, because what we will do will be to solve the initial value problem. So there will be a slice here, some hypersurface, three-dimensional, in a space-time, which is four-dimensional, and we will put data here and solve. And so there will be naturally a direction going to the future and a direction to go to the past. We use basic language from differential geometry, so local coordinates, tangent space, etc., vector fields. And there is this convention of summation over repeated indices that I'm sure you have seen already. Now, in Riemannian geometry, so I assume that you have some knowledge of basic Riemannian geometry. The Riemann curvature tensor, it can be defined from a metric, and the fact that the signature is Lorentzian doesn't change anything to the definitions. By taking the trace of this Riemann curvature, you get the Ricci curvature, and if you take again the trace, you get the scalar curvature of your spacetime. So now these are formulas that I'm writing in four dimensions. So the Greek indices will always go from 0 to 3, so this is by convention, and we will have Latin indices in a few minutes to go from 1 to 3 to actually describe the geometry of an hypersurface like this. And of course, the example, the most trivial example, is given by Minkowski space, which is the topology is just R4, and the metric is given in a so-called Cartesian coordinates. By this very simple formula, right? And this space has vanishing curvature, and that's the beginning of the story. So on top of this space, we will add either matter or we will add perturbations, gravitational waves that are going to propagate in this space-time. Okay, what are the vacuum Einstein equations? So simply the conditions that the Ricci curvature is equal to zero. So that's a description of vacuum space-times. If you take the trace, you of course are going to find that the scalar curvature is vanishing. So that's a class of spacetime that is already, without putting the matter, it's actually already, as if you have seen some of the lectures here, it's a very challenging equation. And in particular, let me mention that there is a decomposition of the Riemann curvature in three parts, the scalar curvature, the Ricci curvature, but only the traceless part of the Ricci curvature. This is the second term that you see on the screen here. And there is a third part called the Weyl curvature. And so this is a decomposition that you can express for any Lorentzian or Riemannian metric. And so if you impose the vacuum Einstein equations, you impose that the Ricci curvature and therefore the scalar curvature is zero. And so you are left with only one quantity, which is the Weyl curvature, which has some interesting properties in itself of conformal invariance, etc. But the point I want to make is that what you have done here, if you have killed the Ricci curvature, right, and you keep the Weyl curvature, and so the Weyl curvature is non-vanishing, and this is a quantity that carries gravitational radiation in the vacuum. Right? So this is a description, there is no matter here, the Weyl curvature propagates the radiation in the space-time, in the vacuum space-time. Now, of course, the full equations are not only that, the full equations are G alpha beta, where G alpha beta, the Einstein gravitational tensor, is a Ricci curvature plus a scalar quantity, scalar curvature like this. So you take this tensor here, this is a quantity that models the gravitation, the geometry part of your spacetime. And now instead of saying that this quantity is equal to zero, you impose that this is equal to a constant, so 8 pi is actually a normalized version of the gravitational constant, times T alpha beta. And T alpha beta contains all the matter. Right? So if I want to solve this problem, to say something about this problem now for non-vacuum spacetimes, I need to prescribe T alpha beta. Right? And now you enter a zoo of many possibilities of how this T alpha beta is defined. Many works are actually done in a vacuum, right? And many talks that you could attend in this lecture would actually study the equations in a vacuum, and they're already enormously hard. But adding the matter is also quite interesting, right? It's interesting, and it introduces very different issues, and it really opened a whole world of questions. Okay, so to proceed, I need to recall a few things from differential geometry, so or Riemannian geometry. The Levi-Civita connection, if you have a metric, there is something which is called the Levi-Civita connection, which allows you to compute derivatives of tensors, of vector fields, functions, etc. And it has the properties that it preserves a metric in this sense, so if you apply it to the metric, you get zero. And it has a property that it is torsion-free. So if you compute the derivative nabla xy minus nabla yx, this is nothing but the Lie bracket. So this Lie bracket is completely independent of the structure. And so what you are saying is that you can compute some other Lie bracket with a connection, and there is no error term. The error would be something you would call the torsion. So the torsion is free in this case. Okay, and now I'm also writing a little bit more explicitly, but you will see this in coordinates in a few minutes. So even if you never took seriously a course of Riemannian geometry, you can still follow that. And so what I want to say, in order to derive the Euler equations, so that's what I want to say now, you have the matter and you want to derive the Euler equations. So what are these Euler equations? So they are obtained from the following observations, that the Riemann curvature has actually a lot of symmetries, which I will not review here, but there are a lot of symmetries that are satisfied by this object here. And in particular, if you express this in coordinates, there is something which are called Bianchi identities, right? And you have a Bianchi identities with five indices, I guess. And if you contract these Bianchi identities twice, you end up with an identity where there is only one index free, and this is the identity I wrote on the blackboard, right? So it says what? It says that if you compute the divergence of the Ricci curvature, you get 1/2 times the gradient of the scalar curvature, okay? So that's just a symmetry, I mean a property of the Riemann curvature. But now I'm using this to derive the Euler equations, and so this is what I want to show you now, that the divergence of T alpha beta is equal to zero, and the proof is rather easy. So you start, we compute nabla beta T alpha beta, you replace by the Einstein tensor G alpha beta by using the Einstein equations, right? And then you just differentiate this G, there was two terms. One term gives you exactly the divergence of the Ricci curvature, and the second term, because G is preserved by the metric, it gives you also exactly the gradient of the scalar curvature. So in the following, if you want to solve the Einstein equations with matter, what you have to do, you have to solve the Einstein equations coupled to the Euler equations. Okay? So the Euler equations can be seen as a consequence of the Einstein equation. So in principle, you could forget about them and only concentrate on the Einstein equations, even with the matter. But in practice, if you want to write a system which is solvable and have a system which is hyperbolic and have energy estimates, etc., you have actually to add to the Einstein equations this system of Euler equations. So that's what we will do. Now the Cauchy developments, right? So we have the equations. We have not written them as a PDE yet, but you can imagine choosing coordinates, we will get a system of PDEs. But before we do that, we have to understand how the initial value problem is formulated, right? So the way this will be done is that you think of a spacetime that you want to construct. Right? And your spacetime should come as the development of some data that you will put in some hypersurface. Right? So what I will call an initial data set is actually the prescription of this hypersurface in a spacetime that you have not constructed yet, but that you want to construct. Right? So at this moment, you concentrate on this hypersurface, and you fix some data. So how do you describe the geometry and the matter component, the matter content of this initial slice in your spacetime? Right? So you proceed in this way. You give a Riemannian three manifold, M bar, G bar. So G bar will be the induced metric on this hypersurface. You supplement this with a symmetric two-covariant tensor field, K bar, which in a minute will play the role of the second fundamental form of this hypersurface after you embed M bar into that bigger spacetime. So these are the geometric data. With the geometric data, you can compute some quantities. I mean, you can look at this metric, Riemannian metric, and tensor field in coordinates. Latin indices, as I said before, go from 1 to 3. You have the connection associated with G bar. You have the scalar curvature for G bar. And from that, you can compute the trace of K. So the trace of K, you can see here a formula. So you want to compute K bar JJ. But what is the meaning of that? So my tensor is defined to be twice covariant with indices below. And so when you want to compute the trace, you do that by using the metric, actually the inverse of the metric. Right? So you have the metric in coordinates, and G bar IJ upstairs is a notation for the inverse of G bar IJ down. The norm is defined in a similar way, right? So you want to contract Kij in this way, so you use a metric twice in order to get a scalar quantity for the norm. Okay. And now these are the last piece, or almost the last piece of information to describe the initial data set. So now it turns out that M bar, G bar, K bar, they cannot be arbitrary because what you want to do next, you want to see them as being part of a spacetime. And so there are relations that are induced if you have a spacetime, then necessarily some Gauss-Kodazy equation have to be satisfied. So there are some equation induced on this hypersurface. And therefore, we will here assume them. Right? So we assume that the data, K bar, G bar, are not arbitrary, but they satisfy certain equations, set of PDEs. These PDEs are actually nonlinear elliptic equations. Right? We will not really look at these constraints. Right? So they are not really important for us. But still, for the whole story, we need to have a look at them. And so these constraints will be assumed on the initial data set. Right? And they come from the fact that otherwise you would not be able to find a solution to your Einstein equation. So this is necessary. Now, and here let me just repeat that this is a scalar curvature, the trace of K, the norm of K, and this is, you have the divergence and you have the gradient of the trace, right? So that is a rather nice structure for these Einstein constraints. But that's not it. So for us, we also have matter terms, right? So I wrote here T00 and T0j, which correspond to some components of the matter. So one is called, this will be called the Hamiltonian constraint, the momentum constraint. So you have additional data. So that's what I will return to that. But you have some additional data which are necessary in order to describe T00 and T0j. So the matter content of your spacetime, initially, I mean, intuitively, it's clear that if you want to solve and generate your spacetime from a data on some hypersurface, of course, you need to know the geometry of this hypersurface, but you also need to know what is the matter content of that. Right? And the way you formulate the matter content of your spacetime, of course, depends on the matter, right? So we will be talking about scalar fields, perfect fluids, and there will be this theory of modified gravity. And for each case, you will have different way to prescribe the matter content of the spacetime on this initial slice. Now, we are able now to to say what is a future development of the initial data set. So it will be a Lorentzian manifold, MJ, dimension 4, satisfying the Einstein equations. And together with this manifold, we need to have an embedding of M bar, our prescribed data, into our spacetime. And I call H the image. And this should be done in such a way, so the embedding is done in such a way that the metric, which is induced from the spacetime metric induced on this hypersurface, should coincide with the one that you have prescribed, G bar. And similarly, K bar should coincide with the second fundamental form of this hypersurface. So it tells you how this hypersurface is curved into the spacetime. The extrinsic curvature of the spacetime is of this hypersurface is described by this form K. And again, solving the problem does not mean only finding a metric and a spacetime. It means also that you have to construct the matter fields on this spacetime. Okay, so that's a general setup that you want to look at. And now to do the analysis, you have to introduce coordinates. So this is what we will do. We'll do that in a couple of different situations. You know, different coordinates will have to be introduced. Sometimes with one set of coordinates, you cannot cover the whole spacetime. Usually the case, but for the application that I have in mind here, and most what is done analytically for the Einstein equations, a single chart is sufficient to cover the whole spacetime. So this is something we will discuss. Choice of coordinates in order to get rid of the diffeomorphism invariance in the problem. And one choice that would be the main choice for today's discussion would be to look at wave gauge, which I mentioned already in the beginning, right? So the wave gauge means the following. You will choose on your spacetime functions that are called x1. So you have some functions, x0, x1, x2, x3. So these are functions from M to R, functions on your manifold, on your spacetime. And each of them is a solution of the wave equation. Okay? But this is the wave equation expressed in terms of the metrics that you don't know. Right? So even that is not such an easy condition. And when this condition is made, the Einstein equations, which in the vacuum, for instance, which equals zero, simplifies and can be expressed as a system of coupled nonlinear wave equations for the metric. So it looks like this. You have box G alpha beta of the coordinates is equal to quadratic terms. And the wave operator that you are using here is one related to the metric. Okay. Okay. So again, you don't need to keep track of everything I'm saying here, because some of that will be what is most important will be repeated in a different form later on. Okay. Now I'm going to describe the matter models. And we start with a so-called self-gravitating massive field model. So what that is, so I need, as we saw before, I need to tell you what is T alpha beta. So for some reason, this laser, they never work for too long. But, okay, so T alpha beta is given by this formula. So it's nabla alpha phi, nabla beta phi. Phi is a scalar field, scalar quantity, defined on the spacetime. And so T alpha beta is a tensor with two indices, and it's a nabla alpha phi, nabla beta phi, minus. And you have essentially, this is a norm, the Lorentzian norm of the gradient, plus a potential times a metric. Right? And so the potential is something which obviously will be taken to be zero if you want to describe massless fields. And for massive fields, the typical choice you are going to make is that V of phi is equal to phi squared, and the constant in front of it is connected to the mass of this field. Okay, so this is one possibility, which is already leads to quite interesting stuff. And if you express the Euler equation, so you compute nabla alpha t alpha beta of this quantity, you can easily see that the Einstein Euler system is in fact equivalent to the following Einstein Klein-Gordon system. Now phi is a solution of a wave equation plus or minus a potential term, and the Ricci curvature minus nabla alpha phi, nabla beta phi plus this potential quantity is equal to zero. Okay. So that's one of the systems we want to study here. And for instance, we will look at nonlinear global stability of Minkowski space for this model later on. In fact, the theory of modified gravity will lead us to a very similar model. And so this is a roughly summary of what we will do for one of our problems. So look at the long-time behavior of perturbations of Minkowski space for a self-gravitating massive field. We have this to study this system of coupled wave Klein-Gordon equations. So I guess here you see that it is there is a Klein-Gordon equation. But it's in fact a wave Klein-Gordon system because the Ricci curvature, as I just said a minute ago, can be replaced by the wave equation for the metric. Right? So you see from here already the structure, but I will show that in more details soon. And so we will look at global nonlinear stability. And so the point is that when you perturb a slice in a model spacetime, you perturb it like Minkowski. What you want to show, that the perturbation will die out, will disperse in the future. Right? And so when you go to the future in the spacetime, you see that the spacetime will resemble more and more the Minkowski space that you perturb in the beginning. So this is what we want to prove, and so what this means is that you have to show a global existence result for the system of PDEs. So this is a PDE aspect of it, how to prove global existence for all times of your coupled system of PDEs. Time decay of solution is what you have to understand. And on the other hand, you want, after solving your PDE problem globally in time, you want to know what that means in terms of the geometry of the spacetime. Right? And that's what we want to show. We will show that the spacetime is geodesically complete in the future. Right? You move to the future in future direction, and you don't want somehow the spacetime to stop in some way. You want it to continue forever. Okay. And the method which will be used behind this I call it the hyperboloidal foliation method. It's based on using hyperboloids in Minkowski space, but this is something I will explain later on. Okay, so this will be, say, one third of what I want to present here. And on the other hand, we will discuss spacetimes with symmetry. And there will be two symmetry assumptions, spherical symmetry, and T2 symmetry, so different group actions that we will assume on the spacetime. The so-called Gaudi or plane symmetry is slightly more restrictive, and I will also show what it is. And so when you put these assumptions, you end up with a nonlinear wave system, pretty much like I just explained, nonlinear wave system. But in this case, it will be in a situation where you have one space variable, one time variable. But yet, these systems are huge, and they have a rather rich structure. And what is quite interesting here, in comparison with the earlier stability of Minkowski that I was discussing, is that here you can treat large data, and you can address situations where the global dynamics of your spacetime is not Minkowski space, is not a small perturbation of something that is rather, physically maybe not that exciting. Right. So you perturb now your spacetime with large data, and you want to observe what is the global geometry of it. So you address long-term issue. You look at the future boundary of your spacetime. What are the properties? So from a PD point of view, you you show global existence result, or maybe you have some limit of the maximal time that you can reach with your PDE. But then you analyze what happens when you reach this boundary, or when you go to in the late time directions. Right? And so by doing that, you may end up by recovering a result pretty much like for the stability of Minkowski, that your spacetime is geodesically complete in the future, or you may find something a little bit much more exciting, the formation of black hole trapped surfaces, collapse of matter, etc. And there are interesting issues that can be dealt with. Now, I want to emphasize that the symmetries that I'm making here could be even stronger, but that's not what I will cover. But there is a class, a so-called class of Bianchi models, which assume a further symmetry assumption. They can even be looked at in a vacuum, right? And so even when you add this additional symmetry, you have a complicated problem which requires techniques of dynamical systems, bifurcation theory, and there are still many open problems. And I will give references in the end if you want to have a look at that, right? So somehow there are different levels of symmetry assumptions and and situations. From a physical perspective, you can treat various situations of different interest. Okay, now, so far I only show you the scalar fields. So now this is another example of matter, compressible matter. This model is relevant to describe the interior of a star, for instance. And I like to analyze in these models is the presence of discontinuities, okay, of shocks. So you start with something initially smooth. So even forget about the geometry. Even in a non-relativistic situation, you can look at the evolution of fluids, and fluids, compressible fluids, generate shocks, generate discontinuities in finite time. So in particular, if you have the coupling with the Einstein equations, of course that's also the case, and then you see an interaction between discontinuities on the stress energy tensor, the T alpha beta, and therefore necessarily by the Einstein equation you must have discontinuities on the curvature, right? And it could even be more singular quantities. So you have curvature discontinuities and shock interactions, and that's something we will study in one of the three problems I stated. This is something I will address. The scalar fields can be seen as a special case, and I'm going to show that in a few minutes to show you how we can go from irrotational null fluids to the scalar field. So you can see the connection that all of that is really part of a big class of matter models, and I'm only looking at a few of them. So from irrotational null fluids to scalar fields, I will explain this in a minute. And then now I can repeat what I said in the beginning. There will be two objectives here: weakly regular Ricci flat spacetimes with T2 symmetry, allowing impulsive gravitational waves. And the next result will be weakly regular matter spacetime with compressible fluids, shocks, assuming spherical symmetry. Right? And these are techniques that can work, a little bit beyond the symmetry, the specific symmetry assumptions that I'm making here. Okay, so far I didn't write the formula for a compressible fluid, so this is now done on the screen. You have the formula for T alpha beta. And you can see, that it depends on two quantities, mu, and U. So mu is, let me show it here, so mu is a proper mass energy density of the fluid, it's a positive quantity, it tells you how much matter you have. It's a function on the manifold. You have also a unit timelike vector field, which describes a velocity, four-dimensional velocity vector in the spacetime. And the way this quantity is defined is that it is time-like, so it's really a vector of this sort. It is time-like. It's oriented toward the future. So by convention, this is really a convention. So you have two half cones, and you decide that one side is a positive part, the other side is a negative part. So here we take this convention that the component u0 should be positive. And also, this vector is normalized to be unit. But unit, since it is time-like, it can only be minus 1. So u alpha is equal to minus 1. Okay. So this is how the matter is described. The matter depends on mu and this vector u. But plus one more quantity, which is a pressure. And the pressure is, if you assume a perfect fluid, so you forget about, you neglect viscosity, you neglect heat conduction. Then you can express the pressure as a function of mu. Okay, so I guess you have everything, except that if the model is hyperbolic, you need to restrict the pressure. So the dp over d mu is a square of the sound speed, the speed of small propagation of fluid in the matter in space time. So you need to restrict the sound speed, and the restriction is that. So dp over d mu, it should be less than 1, and 1 is normalized light speed in this with these notations. And now we can return to the formulation of the Cauchy problem, right? So you remember that in the Cauchy problem we had a Riemannian manifold with its metric and tensor field k bar. But now, in addition to that, we prescribe the matter content on the initial slice by saying that I need to know these quantities, mu and u. And more precisely, what I prescribe is mu bar and j bar. So j bar is the projection, if you like, of u on this hypersurface. Okay. And the formulas are given below by this. So you take t alpha beta. You contract this with a normal to the foliation. Right? So now I'm constructing. Now I'm looking at the Cauchy development. So the Cauchy development is defined like we have seen before. But in addition, now I have to specify the matter fields. So you need also to find not only the metric, but you need also to find a scalar field mu and a vector field j. And these quantities are connected through the normal with t alpha beta. So t alpha beta contracted twice with the normal to the foliation is a mass, the mass energy density measured by an observer moving orthogonally to the slices. And the second quantity is the momentum of this observer. Right? So you have here something which is actually the projection. So g alpha beta plus n alpha n beta, the plus sign, this is something connected with the signature. But it's really the projection that you would know. If you want to project orthogonally to n, you would have this formula with a minus sign, but the plus sign is correct because we are in Lorentzian geometry. And so you project this momentum in order to get j. Okay, so of course the initial data set has to be satisfied in this way, that mu bar, g bar that you have prescribed should coincide with the restriction of g, mu and j that you define in your whole spacetime on the initial hypersurface. Okay, so now there is more to tell you about the momentum stress energy tensor. So it goes like this. You want to be able, indeed, to have this interpretation that when I contract T alpha beta with this normal to the foliation, you want to get something positive, right? So this was implicit in what I said. But in fact, you want a little bit more than that. You want to be able to contract t alpha beta with any vector x alpha, which is time-like. Okay. So I contract it twice, and x alpha, which is time-like, stands for an observer moving in a certain direction. So now, not necessarily orthogonally to the foliation, but it moves within this cone. It moves at the speed, which is less than the speed of light. And so this quantity, the interpretation for this quantity is that this is a mass energy density measured by this observer. Right? So you want, of course, this to be positive. That's a restriction on the matter model that you can consider. And there is a second condition in a similar way, is that for every future-oriented time-like vector, the energy flux is time-like or null, causal means time-like or null, and future-oriented, right? So this quantity gives you the momentum of this observer. Now you return to the specific, so this was a general definition, you return to the perfect fluids, and you can see easily that P has to be restricted by this inequality, right? So the modulus of P should be less than mu, and the proof of that is given here. So if you use the fact that mu is positive, you simply compute T alpha beta, X alpha, X beta. So this is something that you just read from the definition, and using the fact that X and U, so I'm picking up X, which is unit. U, we already have assumed that it is unit by definition of the fluid velocity. And so when you compute this this quantity here, you see that it is indeed positive. And the reason for that is that the scalar product U times X to the square is not less than the product of the norm, which is 1, right? The product of this unit norm. So it's not less, but it is greater than 1. And again, there is a sign, a change. So this is Cauchy-Schwarz inequality, but it's a reverse Cauchy-Schwarz inequality because of the signature that we have on the Lorentzian manifold. So just do the usual proof for Cauchy-Schwarz, and you will see that the sign are changed. And the second observation is that if now we use p square less than mu square, which is the one on the top here, you do the same. So you compute t alpha, you look at t alpha beta x alpha, t gamma delta x delta, I guess there is a mistake with the index here, should be down. And you contract this, right? So you look at the square of that. And you want to show that this is negative, this should be time-like. That's what we require here, it should be time-like. And or causal, so it can be zero or negative, that's what I put here, zero or negative. So this is just the formula from the definition. And you can see that this is the right sign because this quantity, again, this quantity is between plus infinity and one, right? It's bigger than one. So you look at the two limits when it's one, when it's plus infinity, and you see that this is exactly the condition. Okay. Now we have some specific choices here. Isothermal fluid, P is k squared times mu, the linear function of mu. K has to be between 0 and 1 if you want to satisfy the previous conditions. There are now two extreme cases within this, this range. The dust fluid, P taken to be 0, but you can see that it does not satisfy the hyperbolicity condition that I mentioned before. But still, that's an interesting model that can be used, and it's relevant for some application to cosmology, for instance. And there is also the so-called radiation-dominated case where you take the constant k, so the sound speed, to be exactly 1/3. So for some reason, this value is very remarkable in some of the models, and you have, for instance, some results that would hold if you have the sound speed which is between 0 and 1/3. So this is a range which is in a certain way more stable than higher velocity, right? So small sound speeds actually are preferable for stability of the matter than bigger sound speed, which is intuitively, but there are results that prove that. Okay, and the last case here is taking the pressure to be a constant, so minus mu, I define it to be another constant, capital lambda over 8 pi, so this is, if you like, just a notation. P is constant, that's the main assumption that we are making, and constant and equal to minus mu. And if you express the Einstein equations with the matter, actually T alpha beta now will be simply minus lambda G alpha beta, and I have a way here to recover the cosmological constant. So usually, or sometimes, this cosmological constant will be introduced in the left-hand side of the equations. But you can as well see it as being introduced as part of the pressure. Okay. So Now, I would like now to explain how you go from this model of perfect fluids with some additional condition of irrotationality and the flood being null. So how you go from that to the scalar field. Right? So there are a couple of pages to show you the reduction now. Okay. So we start with the equation of T alpha beta that we had. So T alpha beta, we had a formula with a pressure. And inside this formula, I'm assuming that the pressure is equal to the mass energy density. Right? So we are in the extreme range of the range where the sound speed could go from 0 to 1. So I'm now taking the upper bound for the pressure. So compute T alpha beta, and you will get this. So you still have a dependence in terms of mu and u. Sound speed equal light speed. And you start by expressing the second contracted Bianchi identities to, in other words, the Euler equations. So what I did here, I simply put a nabla alpha maybe on top of this, right? So 2 mu, maybe I have divided by 2. This product produce 3 terms, and this guy is giving me the gradient of mu, right? So that's pretty obvious. And I add this assumption. So there are two assumptions. You can play with this, right? You can put one of the two assumptions and see what sort of reduction you obtain. But at least for today, I'm showing this. So the second condition I'm putting is that the velocity has a potential, is a gradient of a potential. But of course, u being unit, it would not make sense to say u alpha is nabla alpha of psi. So I have to normalize and I therefore divide by nabla psi, which is the square of the norm or the gradient. And of course, this quantity u is timelike, so the norm would be negative, so I have put a minus sign here. Okay? And we proceed, right? So we multiply, we have these Euler equations, it depends on one index, and I first multiply by u beta in order to obtain this, right? So I guess you should see this relation here, and what I'm going now is that I'm going to multiply by a u. This is what I will do first, u beta, do that. I guess maybe I can just, show you that quickly and you can go through the details of the calculation. Everything should be on the screen, right? So one part of the calculation is multiply by u beta and see what you get, right? So you get that. You get this statement. 1/2 u alpha nabla alpha mu, which is like the directional derivative of the density. And there is another contribution here, which is the divergence of the velocity times mu, right? So the structure is rather clear. Now I will set m to be 1/2 of the log of the density, right? So you divide this by mu, and you get u alpha nabla alpha of m, so the propagation of transport of m, plus the divergence of the velocity is equal to 0. Structure is rather nice. And the other thing I can do, I can multiply by the projection operator. And this is something we have seen before, but we have seen it with a normal here. So what I'm doing here is that I take the metric, I add u alpha u beta with a plus sign, and this defines the projection operator. Well, now not associated with this normal, but it is associated with the u, the velocity of the fluid. Right? So there are always two natural frame, if you like, a projection that you can make in this problem for fluids. So this is a projection that I'm taking now, and you can believe me that this is a relation that you obtain, and if you divide by mu, you introduce this m, that's what you get. Right? So the structure is slightly more involved, but there is a projection that I did not make more explicit times gradient of the density, and here you have some products. So this is more complicated, right? Transport u alpha nabla alpha of the components of the velocity. Okay? And we continue, and now there are some more computations, but everything is really elementary. So I have skipped that. And I'm just showing you what you get if you impose u alpha to be nabla alpha psi over this norm. So some elementary computations will produce this. So what is that? So you have one equation, which is a box, you know, it's really a wave equation, nabla alpha psi. It's weighted by the norm of the gradient of psi. And it's also weighted by the density, mu to the power of 1/2. It's completely elementary. You manipulate the equations, the ones that, the scalar one, and you get this. And then you do something similar for the vectorial equation, and you see that the nabla of m, right? So you remember that we did have a, anyway, I mean, there's some algebra, but so maybe you cannot see it right away. But in any case, so that's what you get, right? You get nabla beta of m minus the log of this norm is equal to, and you manipulate this a little bit to realize that it's a scalar quantity, and the expression is given here, okay? This is a scalar quantity, times nabla beta of psi. And now we are almost at the end of this reduction. So what we have found in the second equation, that the gradient of this quantity, right, this combination of psi and m, is parallel to the gradient of psi. And you can convince yourself that this means that this quantity is a function of psi. Right, so you can at least see easily the other way around, that if this quantity is equal to some psi of f of psi, of course, if you differentiate, you will get some factor here, f prime of psi times nabla psi, right? So this is really a solution of that. But in fact, there are no other solution. I mean, maybe there are some assumptions to really formulate, but at this level, it's a little bit formal. I'm not trying to necessarily describe all that could be exceptional solution that would satisfy this, but I'm not interested in those. So we are almost done. Now there is a freedom that rather than saying that this is a function of f of psi, you can actually change the potential. And by changing the potential, you realize that you can make this quantity to vanish. Okay? So this is the conclusion. The conclusion is that we have a relation between m and the log of square root of nabla alpha psi, nabla alpha psi, which is 0. And so we have found, if you remove the log, we have found that the mass energy density of the fluid can actually be computed from the potential. Right. So that's a nice situation. Normally, as you will see later on, that's not what you have. I mean, you have an evolution equation for the density of the matter and also for the velocity. Right, you have two equations. But this is because we have made this irrotationality assumption. We have this nice reduction that mu can be expressed if you know the velocity, if you like, the norm of the velocity field. And so that's what I wanted to tell you. The Einstein Euler system for irrotational null fluids is equivalent to a wave equation for the fluid potential coupled to the Einstein equation for the metric. Okay? And if you return to the Einstein equations and the expression for T alpha beta, you will realize that this is as simple as that. R alpha beta is equal to a constant nabla alpha phi, nabla beta phi. Okay? So you see all this connection of various models, and which I think is interesting. And so the end of the story here is that if you solve this, of course, you define u, the velocity, to be nabla psi normalized. You define mu to be this. And you have solved your Einstein-Euler system by actually solving a wave equation coupled to the Einstein equations. Okay. And this is really a non-massive situation. So that's something that is definitely easier than the massive case. There is actually something which resembles that very much, which is called the Bernoulli law, that you may have seen if you took classes in fluid dynamics, classical fluid dynamics. So it says the same thing, but without all this relativistic stuff. Okay, so we arrive at more or less the end of the first hour, and I can now return to the outline that I gave in the beginning, and with to somehow summarize what we want to do here. The introduction to the matter model is not finished, and we will be talking about the modified gravity in a minute. But then let me now give again an overview of what we will be doing. So we'll be first looking at weakly regular Ricci flat spacetime. So we will define weak solutions to the Einstein equations with singular curvature defined as a distribution. This will be interesting from a physical perspective to cover impulsive gravitational waves. So these are singularities that are concentrated on null hypersurfaces in a spacetime. And we'll do this analysis, understand how weak regular geodesics can be defined. So of course, the geodesics are important object if you want to study the geometry of the spacetime. So how are they defined in a spacetime where the curvature is not defined, at least not classically? We will look at late-time asymptotics and eventually conclude with a completeness in at least two cases. So Gaudi case is a simpler symmetry of this sort, and polarized T2 is slightly stronger than T2. And in fact, the T2 case, the full T2 case, even after 30 years of studies on these equations, has not been solved yet in terms of that, right? So I will really restrict for the final result here to the so-called polarized T2 case. And the reason is what I explained briefly before, is that even if you had one more symmetry assumed, the dynamics is still very complicated, right? So there is always some limit, and every time you want to, you know, to push the limit a little bit more, you have usually to work hard to understand what is the global dynamics of this. The second result will be essentially the same questions, but now with a matter, with a compressible matter, with shocks included. The spacetime will be also defined in a weak sense, with bounded variation regularity will be the natural regularity behind this. And there will be some other notions here that will come about, the Riemann problem, the random choice method, and we will finally have results about the global geometry. But again, this will be slightly weaker in terms of generality compared to the previous setup. And the reason is that when you go from you know, one problem to the other, you add the matter, and the matter is again changing the dynamics of the geometry very, very much. Okay, and the last result I already mentioned, stability of Minkowski space for self-gravitating massive fields. And what I will explain after the break will be this this structure, the connection, Einstein massive fields, modified gravity, Einstein Klein-Gordon, right? So all this connection will become clear after in the second part today. And to finish, we start after the break. We'll do that, but before we stop, I want to give you references, right? So there are textbooks here that should cover what you need. I mean, much more than what you need. These are huge books, and you should at least look at the first few chapters and refer to these books whenever you have questions. But please also come to see me during the break or at another time. You can send me an email. So I wrote my email address here, so feel free to contact me. So the book of Choquet-Brua was recent and quite good. And Galloway, so he gave lectures here on Lorentzian geometry in September. Maybe some of you have attended the lectures. And so he has notes. O'Neill is a classical book also on Lorentzian geometry. And the book of Wald is more about the physics of these problems. And I finished now with this. So I told you that there was a class with higher symmetry assumed, and I put here two papers and a book, and you can have maybe a brief look at them to see how complex the dynamics can be, even with this so-called Bianchi spacetimes. Okay, so we make a break because there is a tea that we should follow at. So in the second floor, you can go and get a tea break of the Institute. And so we resume at 3:30. The theory of modified gravity has been introduced, has a very long history in physics. And it was in fact introduced very soon, as you can see from this date here, very soon after Einstein, the theory of Einstein. So very soon after, people realized that in the action that defines, and we will see that the Hilbert-Einstein action defining the equations, so the theory of modified gravity has a very long history in physics. So Weyl, Pauli, Eddington, and other people, and the basic idea from the theory of Einstein. So in the theory of Einstein, you have the action, which is defined by the integral of the scalar curvature, and I'm going to revisit that quickly in a few minutes. And so it's rather natural to replace the scalar curvature by a function of the scalar curvature, which of course you will take as an approximation of R. So we are going to play now a little bit with this action, integral of f of R times the volume form, and the function f of R will be taken to be R plus a correction, right? Typically quadratic correction, kappa, R squared, maybe plus higher order terms. Okay, so it seems to be, you know, much more fancy and to make the theory much more complicated, but you will see that actually it does not. So this, for me, modifying the classical gravity in this way, as I said before, is really a way to introduce a matter or the effect of a matter in a rather canonical way, with only one parameter. If you only take a function, you know, with one parameter kappa, so you give me kappa, and you have a theory which is actually equivalent to classical Einstein plus Klein-Gordon, plus a massive field. Okay. But it's interesting to see the reduction and how it goes. So let's do that. At first, you have the impression that the theory will be much more complicated, because instead of two derivatives of the metric like you have with the Einstein equations, you will have now four derivatives of the metric. From a physical point of view, this is interesting because it gives you some additional degrees of freedom, of gravitational degrees of freedom in your theory. So this is rather attractive physically. And it was indeed used and motivated by studies in cosmology. There is a very broad literature in physics to study this model, variants of this model. So I guess below I will show you with this line a couple of functions that are being introduced, so quadratic correction or a power or some other function. So physicists have played with that. I mean, this is not something we will look too much. For us, this is just a quadratic correction. You think of this function first. And it has been used to explain the accelerated expansion of the universe, even also the structure, the formation of structure in the universe, how the galaxies collected together somehow, attracted together. So this is one model among, as I said before, other models of physics. So we are not doing physics here. For us, or even for physicists, one way to motivate that is to say that you don't need to add specifically dark matter, dark energy, something additional, but in a rather geometric way, you extend your model and you add some degrees of freedom. Of course, there are other alternative theories of gravity, and the philosophy behind this series is that the gravitational field now is described, if you like, not only by a metric, but only by some additional fields. So the scalar fields are not regarded immediately like matter, but they are thought of as additional degrees of freedom for the gravitation. And so here I put some of the names: Brunt-Dekker series, scalar tensor series of gravity. And these models are either more general compared to what I present today, or less general. It really depends on the way you do the coupling between the geometry and the matter. And this coupling is quite important, and we will be discussing that in a few minutes. So the objective for today is simply to describe the structure of the equations of modified gravity. And in the same time, this is a way for you to better understand the equations of classical gravity as well. And something I will be doing today is to introduce what is called the augmented conformal formulation of the model, right? And you can maybe imagine that by doing this new formulation, this reformulation of the equation, we'll be able to go from four derivatives of the metric, which will be the original, the initial formulation, to a formulation where there will be only second derivatives of the metric plus an additional scalar field. And the structure will be, again, Einstein-Klein-Gödel. In recent years, there have been a validation of that, mathematical validation of this model, which tells you that the modified theory is indeed a correction to Einstein's theory. So to state that, I forgot how much I will show you today of this, but the philosophy is that you want to revisit how the initial data set is defined for modified gravity. And have the initial formulation also stated. And to say that this is a correction means that if I take this kappa here in the definition of the function, the choice of the function f, to be very small, of course, physically you expect the modified spacetimes to be close to the Einstein spacetimes, right? And this is indeed the case, and you can underline that all of that is very robust. Okay, so we can start without knowing too much. We start again from the beginning that we have a four-dimensional space-time manifold with a Lorentzian signature. Right? So I start just from the very beginning, and I just tell you now that there is an action to derive the Einstein equations. You have an action called the Hilbert-Einstein's action, defined by this. This is the integral of the scalar curvature plus the effect of the matter. So there is a Lagrangian depending on some fields. In this notation, I just call phi the matter field. But you can, of course, think of putting here the compressible fluid. So this Lagrangian could be a function of the density and the velocity field that we have seen for perfect fluids. And from that, this is what we do. We choose now the massless scalar field, which is called, so this is said, this whole model is said to be minimally coupled. The matter is minimally coupled to the geometry. And what it means what is written here, and non-minimally coupled would mean that there is some additional effect here of the curvature or the metric. I mean, the coupling will be stronger between the two terms in some sense. And the stress energy tensor is the one that I wrote before, right? T alpha beta is the one that I wrote before. And because I'm going anyway to get a massive field in a minute by describing the theory of modified gravity, I don't need to also put it here, right? So here, just think of a simpler situation of a massless field. The principle of least action tells you that the preferred metric are the metrics that are critical points for this action. So you have to compute the variation of the action at some phi and some metric j, and say that this is zero. And so if you do that, and don't worry, I will show you this in a few minutes, you obtain the Einstein equation. So g alpha beta is equal to this, equal to the matter. So I'm just repeating that now these equations can be derived, can be obtained by minimization or extremization of an action. In a vacuum case, let me repeat that if there is no T alpha beta, you obtain the Ricci flat condition out of this. And now let's repeat that. And again, I will give the proof in a minute. So don't worry that you may not have seen the precise expression for the scalar curvature yet. If you repeat the same page now for modified gravity, you simply replace the scalar curvature by a function of the scalar curvature. You probably want to keep the Lagrangian for the matter to be just the same. And you prescribe a function f. So I want to think of it as being expanded in terms of in this term, kappa r squared plus a correction kappa r cubed. And I have in mind, at least to show the stability of Minkowski space, this kappa is fixed or is small, but r would be small. It's a correction, right? It's a correction to the first term. The sign Which, of course, here is not clear why it's the case, but the sign of kappa is actually essential if you want to prove global stability of this model. So kappa is very important, and it will be related to the sign of the Klein-Gordon model, which we will see. Again, we look for critical points of this action, and not similarly as before, we actually now get something much more complicated. Okay, but not so complicated as you will see. So we get, instead of, maybe I could write this, rewrite it on the blackboard, so you have it. So we have f prime of r, so I have actually two versions, but let's say for this one, so f prime of r alpha beta minus f of r over 2. So you see that this is a generalization of what you had in the Einstein equations. But you have one more term with this form, right? So g alpha beta. So in addition to that, you have g alpha beta box g minus nabla alpha nabla beta. And all of that, so this is an operator, right, that you apply. I mean, it depends on alpha beta. And you apply this to f prime of r. Okay. So of course, it's obvious that if I choose f to be r, this is gone, right? F prime is one, this is gone, and this is r, right? So okay, that's a correction, clearly, at this level, you can see it. And there is another form that I suggest to also to have, which is a second line, where actually I extracted the g alpha beta, and I put some remainder, you know, in a certain sense. So again, this will be zero if f is r, and again, this part is the same as the previous line. Okay. So now what I want to do, I want to play with conformal transformations and explain that you can actually reduce the difficulty or this expression, simplify this expression. And by simplifying this expression, you will actually eliminate some of the apparent difficulties, which is a fact that you have an operator, a second order operator, which is applied to a function of the scalar curvature, which itself involves two derivatives of the metric. Right? So this looks quite ugly, but in fact it is not. A lot of structure behind that I want to show. Okay, and now what are the field equations of modified gravity? N alpha beta equal 8 pi t alpha beta, as you could guess. And we will now proceed with this. Okay, and basically what we are going to show, we are going to show that this is equivalent to treat in a certain metric, which I will call G DAG, we will actually reduce this problem to the Einstein equation for another metric, right? Coupled with some additional matter. So this will be coupled with a massive scalar field. And this massive scalar field will actually essentially or exactly will be f prime of r. Okay? In a sense that I need to explain to make this clear. But this is this equivalence that I will show today. And later we will not return, really, I mean, maybe at the very end, but not return to modified gravity. I mean, again, this is a way for you to, you know, to play with this and get used to these equations and then concentrate on Einstein Klein-Gordon. Okay, so we proceed now by, so there are two or three slides to explain the derivation of the field equations. Okay, so just go, I need to go a little bit fast, but after you will get the notes and you can read the details of that. So variation with respect to the metrics, that's what you want to do, right? To go from the action to the field equations. So I'm writing in coordinates a volume form like this, square root of minus g. So g is a determinant. It's negative because the signature is Lorentzian. And I compute the variation of the action, right? So in the action, if you somehow replace the volume form by square root of minus g dx, you just write minus g f of r, right? That's one term, you differentiate. I mean, this is completely formal at this level. You just differentiate formally, delta over delta g alpha beta. You do the same for the matter contribution. It's weighted by the volume form, square root of minus g, right? So it's completely straightforward. And you get the field equation. So it seems too simple, but that's not it. So you do that, and you just say that now the coefficient in front of delta g alpha beta should vanish. That's what I did below, right? This is that. 16 pi, blah, 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 is minus 16 pi, blah, 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 right? And what I did, in addition, I have divided by 1 over square root of minus g, right? Which is, it doesn't change anything, okay? But the advantage is that this is really something that I can view as 8 pi t alpha beta. So next step is, of course, to compute what this really means. And you observe on one side, you have square root of minus g f of r here. And what I'm doing here is just expand this. I'm just saying that there is a derivative of the volume form, and you have a derivative of the scalar curvature. Right. So just product rule. Okay, so we are not yet at the end of the story, because now if you want to get the equation which is on the blackboard, so I'm really concentrating on the effect of the curvature, what you need to be able to do now is to compute the variation of the scalar curvature with respect to the metric, so delta r, delta g alpha beta, to show that this is a Ricci curvature. And you have to show that the variation of the volume form with respect to the metric is this metric g alpha beta. Okay. So these are two identities. You can check that these two identities are exactly what you need to recover the equation. And now what I do next, I show you two pages, two slides that give you the derivation of these two identities, right? Variation of the scalar curvature with respect to the metric is Ricci. Variation of the volume form with respect to the metric is equal to the metric. Okay? So let's see that. Variation of the volume form. It can take a long time if I really want to tell you everything step by step. So I may simply show this and suggest that you go through the algebra. It's completely elementary. Right. Look at all of that. This is an elementary algebra. And the second page is a little bit less elementary, variation of the scalar curvature. Because now, I didn't use anything, right? I have a metric, depends on two index. I'm just writing that g alpha beta upstairs is the inverse of g alpha beta downstairs. I'm writing the definition of the determinant, etc. Right? So there's really nothing in this page. But in the next page, of course, there is some content, which is to start from the definition of the Riemann curvature. So you have to remember maybe a course on Riemannian geometry. So that's the definition of the Riemann curvature from the Christoffel symbols. You differentiate this relation and you get a bunch of terms, like the first two, you just put a delta and you put a delta on the second term. But now you have products, right? So you have two terms that become four terms. It's really, look at it without checking all the indices and check the indices later. And now you see that you have derivative or variation of the Christoffel symbols that come here, right? So I want to come out connect this with the variation of the Christoffel symbols. So that's what I do next. I compute the covariant derivative of the Christoffel symbol. So this is really the definition of the covariant derivative, right? So you take this guy, you add a nabla lambda, and the way it works is that you differentiate. So this d lambda means a classical derivative with respect to some coordinates. And then the way that you differentiate a tensor here is really to multiply by the gamma times whatever you have here, right? This is basically the same quantity that you recover here, multiplied by the gamma. And then you have a minus gamma. This is you check that if you don't know how to do the basic algebra, but otherwise just follow the formula as they have written. And then you can now compute. I mean, you realize now that the variation of delta of the Riemann curvature is actually pretty simple, right? So if you want the variation of this, actually all these terms can be absorbed into this notation, and you get a very very simple formula for the variation of the Riemann curvature. Now you contract two indices. You get the Ricci curvature. So take this, contract two indices. This is straightforward. Contract two more indices. You get the scalar curvature. It's given by this formula. And that's what you wanted to prove, right? So I don't expect you to see the details of this calculation if you have never seen that before. But please go through that. It's elementary, and everything you need to know is written here. And if not, just come to see me, and I will give you more details. Okay. So now we have the equations, and now we continue, right? So we have derived, at least in rough lines, we know how to derive this equation. And now what I want to do next is write the Euler equations corresponding to this and explain you how you can do a reduction to end up with the Einstein Klein-Gordon. So that's what we are going to do now. So you remember these contracted Bianchi identities, right? We have seen that before. So divergence of r alpha beta is 1/2 of the gradient of r, right? So before we use that to check that the divergence of the Einstein tensor was vanishing, and now, what I claim now is that the same property is true for the modified gravity tensor n alpha beta. So why is it so? So look at the formula for n alpha beta. It is on the blackboard. So this is a quantity that I have called n alpha beta. And compute the covariant derivative of this. So you do that, just look step by step, right? So let's look at this carefully. So nabla alpha f prime of r alpha beta, right? This is our first term in the definition of n alpha beta. So you just have a product, right? So you compute r alpha beta nabla alpha f prime of r for one part, plus f prime of r nabla alpha r alpha beta for the second part, right? And for the second part, you can use the Bianchi identities, which are above, right? So I can replace divergence of Ricci by gradient of the scalar curvature. So that's just one identity. And then you have two more of the same spirit, where now you compute the divergence of this guy here, f of r over 2 times the metric, right? So you do this, nabla alpha, f of r, the metric, you can drop, the G does not vary, it's preserved by the connection, so it's gone. And then you expand this, and you get something proportional to the gradient of the scalar curvature. And the last term seems a bit more messy, because it's already, fourth order here. So this is the third term in the definition of n alpha beta, and you put a nabla alpha in front of it, right? So it doesn't look so nice in the beginning, but this is what you get, nabla alpha, nabla beta, minus nabla lambda, f prime of r. So what I put here, I just switch the indices. So you can always do that, right? The indices can be raised and lowered because the metric is preserved by nabla, right? So you can put the indices whenever you want. And so I put the indices in this way, so that I have the same nabla alpha here and here, and in front of this nabla alpha, I have either nabla alpha, nabla beta, or nabla beta, nabla alpha. Right? And so this commutator is actually, by the so-called Ricci identity, is exactly the Ricci curvature. Now this is equal to the Ricci curvature of whatever vector field we had here. Okay, and now just collect all these terms, and if you collect all of that, you realize that we have proven that nabla alpha and alpha beta is equal to zero. Okay? So we are somehow on a good track of realizing that this model that looks so ugly actually is not that ugly, and we have the same conservation law for this tensor, this modified gravity tensor that we had for Einstein. Now we move to the matter. I mean, coupling with the matter is something a little bit delicate. And it works like this. From a physical point of view, in order for me to tell you, or for the physicists to tell you what is a stress-energy tensor in a given situation, they actually need to choose a frame. And for us, it would mean, so there will be the Jordan frame and the Einstein frame. And what this means is, what did I do? Ah, le câble. Aha. Okay. Jordan frame, Einstein frame. Okay, so let me move on. So there will be two metrics in this problem. There is the original metric G alpha beta that I introduced to define the model. And there will be a second metric, conformally transformed metric, that will be the one on the screen here. So G dag alpha beta is equal to F prime of the scalar curvature G alpha beta. So that is a factor, it's a conformal transformation. But the factor depends, it's not just a real function, I mean a scalar function. It's a function of the unknown, of the scalar curvature of the unknown metric. Right? So it's rather an involved change of metric. And so both quantities are important in physics, and one is referred to as the Jordan metric or Jordan frame, and the other one as the Einstein metric or Einstein frame. And now it's going to depend, there is a debate by physicists whether one is a physically relevant metric in which you should do the measurement, or whether the other one is the one you should use as being most physical. Okay. And depending on the choice you will make, from our point of view, this is going to lead to different systems of PDEs to be solved, so that's an important point. And for physicists, I mean, they just describe the matter coupling in different way, which is minimal or non-minimal. So minimal in the Jordan metric means that T alpha beta is taken to be the same as before for a scalar field. And non-minimal in the Jordan metric means that in addition to this quantity, you have a scalar quantity, which is again the same factor, F prime of R, which you put in front of this expression of T alpha beta. And this is something I call a T alpha beta dag. Okay? So different models, different way to describe the matter, and physical, a lot of debates on that. Now, so let's look at it from our point of view. So Jordan's matter coupling is given by this formula. So since we have understood just a few minutes ago that the divergence of n alpha beta is zero, these are our Euler equations. So we started from this, or from the analog with the Ricci curvature, and we actually derived that the divergence of n alpha beta was zero. And therefore, by the modified gravity equation, we deduce that nabla alpha of T alpha beta is zero. And I compute what it is, right? So you start with this. You put a nabla alpha on each of these terms. So you have a product, etc. So you this is a square, this is a product, so you get two terms out of that, and you get one term coming from this square quantity. So if you factor out the terms, this is actually only just equivalent to the gradient of phi multiplied by the box g of phi equals zero. So you see that the scalar field, I mean, this is what I've been repeating from the beginning today, is that the scalar field satisfies a wave equation, nabla g phi is equal to zero, associated with the unknown metric. Okay. So this is a coupling that you get by, you know, the original metric and using a scalar field. But physicists like to do the coupling differently and choose T alpha, or some physicists, T alpha beta to be F prime of R times this quantity. Okay. So let's see what it gives. Right. And this is what it gives. So you still now have nabla alpha t dag alpha beta is equal to zero, because again, what I'm just using here is the fact that the divergence of the modified gravity tensor vanishes. And so, so this divergence relation now will be this. So there are more terms. You could see, in a certain way, this term is the term that we had before, right? So nabla beta phi box phi, this is what we had in the previous slide. It's now multiplied by f prime of r, but there is one more term involving the gradient of the scalar curvature contracted with t alpha beta times the second derivative of f. Okay, it's obvious from this line. One more term, you just two derivative. I mean, you put the derivative nabla alpha on the first term, and you get the second derivative here. This is equivalent to the second line. So box phi nabla beta phi. So now instead of being zero, this is equal to a big quantity here. So okay, so it's what it is. So you play a little bit with that, and you can rewrite this relation in the following way. So you can rewrite this relation as a scalar quantity, right? So this scalar quantity comes from this term here, and there was a box phi which was here. So you add these two terms, you get that guy, this guy. And here, this is what is left out, right? So this part goes here, and you have the second derivative here. Okay. I have written the indices differently, but it doesn't matter. And what we have obtained is that the gradient of phi times the scalar quantity should now be equal to the gradient of the scalar curvature of the spacetime time. Again, a scalar quantity, right? But remember that our Euler equations are equations to be satisfied by the scalar field, by the matter, right? And the matter, when you have a scalar field, has only one degree of freedom. It's only a scalar function, right? If you have a perfect fluid, you have more degrees of freedom. You have mu and j, u, and so you have more degrees of freedom. But in this case, you have only a phi. So you are really looking for a scalar equation. And so the only way or basically there is no way to satisfy this. The unknown is a scalar field, it's overdetermined, and you simply conclude that mathematically, and maybe you should also say physically, this coupling is not well behaved. Okay. So that's really not the way that the matter should be coupled to the geometry. It should be the first way. But yet, the metric, I mean the factor f prime of r that you see here, is going to be very important, because I'm going to keep the idea that, so I go back a few slides, I'm going to keep the idea that this conformal metric, which motivated the introduction of this different coupling of the matter, I'm going to keep this as an important metric to be used. Right. So I will do now, I will look at the Jordan coupling. But I will express the equations in the Einstein frame, with the Einstein metric. Okay, so you have somehow to combine both things to proceed. And so here we are now. I'm going to repeat the story about Cauchy developments, initial data sets, which I presented for classical gravity. And now I repeat that for the modified gravity, right? So you can, in this way, you can see it a second time. So a Cauchy development, Cauchy development will be defined now. So we write the field equation of modified gravity. That's what we are interested in. They are based on a choice of function f of r, roughly like r plus a correction. And the assumption that we will make for the theory are that f is increasing and the second derivative is positive, so you can check that this is obviously the case of r plus kappa r squared. And we do the case where the matter is described by a massless scalar field with this Jordan coupling that I explained. The initial data set, so you remember that what we had before. So the geometry of the initial hypersurface is described by Riemannian manifold M bar G bar plus a second fundamental form K bar. The matter content, if we are talking about a massless scalar field, will be the initial value of phi zero on the M bar, plus the time derivative, or the Lie derivative of phi. Right? With phi satisfy the wave equation. So of course, the initial value and the time derivative are the two data that you will need in order to formulate the initial value problem. And in addition to that, so remember that our equations are fourth order, right? So it should not be true that only the geometry g bar, k bars should be sufficient. We need to add more degrees of freedom, and the degrees of freedom will be the spacetime scalar curvature and the time derivative of this quantity. Of course, at this level, we are only saying that we have a Riemannian manifold with a tensor field k bar plus 1, 2, 3, 4 scalar fields, right, defined on this manifold. And it's only when you formulate the notion of Cauchy development that you connect this with what I said. So let me repeat. An initial data set M bar, G bar, K bar, R0, R1, phi 0, phi 1 consists of a Riemannian 3 manifold, a symmetric 2 tensor field, 2 scalar fields defined on M to stand for the matter and the time derivative, 2 scalar fields playing the role of the space-time curvature and its time derivative. And again, like we have seen before, if you hope to produce a space-time, you, of course, need the so-called Gauss-Kodaty equation to be satisfied, right? So there's some additional equations to be imposed on your data. And you should recognize, you can recognize here, the expression that we have seen for classical gravity. It was this quantity here. Here before, I guess I only wrote T00, but T00 was meant to be the energy measured by an observer, blah, blah, blah. And so if you have a scalar field, you can check that this is this quantity. It's a time derivative of phi, which we have denoted phi 1 as far as the initial data is concerned. And this is a gradient of phi. So you should recognize here, if you like, dt phi squared plus nabla phi squared. This is the energy of the wave equation. That's what is written here, the T00 component. Okay? And there is one more big term here, which comes from the fact that we are doing the modified gravity. Right? So here, even if you forget this and that, what I'm telling you in addition to what I showed before for the constraint is that I'm writing here what is T00 expression for a scalar field. Right? It's like this. And the second condition, the momentum constraint of modified gravity, same part as before, so divergence of k and the gradient of the trace. This part we had before. The other side here, this is really the momentum. So this is really like dt of phi times nabla phi. It's a flux in a wave equation. If you write the energy conservation for the wave equation, as I said before, you get the energy dt phi squared plus nabla phi squared, and you get here the product of dt phi times nabla phi. Right? So this is a T0j component. And because we do modified gravity, we have one more coefficient here, and we have one more big term here. Okay? I mean, again, I'm showing that because I want someone to introduce a subject, but realize that next time we will not actually directly work with that, right? So this will be part of the background that is good to know. But then from next week we will put this assumption of symmetry and be somehow revisiting all of that in a you know different situation, some different setup. So you don't need to absorb all of that to follow the next course, the next class, not at all. Okay, so we have this notion of initial data set, and of course a modified gravity Cauchy development will be a Lorentzian manifold together with matter field, satisfying the field equation of modified gravity that I'm writing here, and embedding in order to realize the given manifold M bar as an hypersurface in the spacetime in such a way that the induced metric G bar or G is in new symmetry coincide with the prescribed data G bar. A second fundamental form is K bar like before. The restriction of the matter fields, phi 0, phi 0, phi 1, they coincide with restriction of phi and the time derivative of phi with respect to the normal to the foliation. And two more conditions, which are the two lines below, which is that the scalar curvature of the spacetime should coincide with R0, our data, and the time derivative of the scalar curvature should also coincide with our data R1. Right? So these, of course, are conditions that you don't need in a non-modified gravity. These are conditions that you will deduce from the rest of the data. Right? But here in this setup, you need to prescribe them. So you need two data. And the Cauchy development, so this is a theorem that I'm showing you now briefly, is that if you have an asymptotically flat, so whatever it means, so you have this initial data set with some proper global assumption. And there is a unique maximal globally hyperbolic development of this. So here I'm stating briefly this result that if you have this slice with a manifold M bar, G bar, K bar, and now we have phi 0, phi 1 for the matter, and we have R 0, R 1 for the additional geometry. So if you have that, then you can produce this spacetime. Okay, so this part of the spacetime can be obtained by solving the equation. You choose coordinates. I mean, this is a very long story. This goes back to the pioneering work by Choquet-Brua in the 50s. The fact that you can solve locally the Einstein equation from such data, and you get a spacetime. But in a certain sense, what you produce is only a piece of a spacetime. You say nothing about the boundary of the spacetime, how big it is, whether it's complete, or etc. And these are issues that we will address later, and I will explain you what setup we will be working with. Okay, and in addition to this classical result, there is a statement that if you look at the modified gravity situation, and you take data that are somehow close to data that will generate the Einstein spacetime, satisfying the Einstein equations. So if you are in that situation, then the development of these data are going to remain close to the corresponding development of the Einstein initial data. Okay. So again, I mean, this is to give you an idea of the sort of results that we will prove. But that's something to be revisited later on. So it's certainly a highly singular limiting problem. Let me maybe not elaborate too much on that. I suggest that you look at some of the books for very basic elementary notion of causality, right? So a timelike curve is a curve whose tangent vector is timelike, right? You can look at this curve. So these curves can be timelike or null. So causal curve will be the situation where the tangent vector is timelike or null. So these curves describe, in a picture I made before, they describe the trajectories of observers or the trajectories of light if they are null. These curves are used in order to define the notion of global hyperbolicity. What is really meant by an initial data hypersurface that you can use to actually solve the initial value problem and define the notion of maximal globally hyperbolic development like I briefly sketched in the theorem. Okay. So the situation here is that there are... you may have a look at the book of Choquet-Brua or the notes of Galloway to have a general background about this subject. If you are interested in looking at the modified gravity, there are a few papers that I... Okay, so what I would like to show you next and to finish is actually to express the equation. So you have understood, right? You have understood that I'm looking at the Einstein equations with a massive field. Right. I've also looked at modified gravity, which contains a massive field in itself. right? So I have these two models, whatever, you know, two are basically equivalent from my point of view. And I want to formulate the equations in coordinates, right? So that's what we have to do. You have to introduce coordinates. So we have nothing on the screen, if you could fix that. Okay, so the last part for this chapter is a formulation in wave gauge. So choosing coordinates, you can think of either problem. So Einstein, massive field, or modified gravity. You want to introduce coordinates and reduce the Einstein massive field problem to a nonlinear huge coupled system of nonlinear wave Klein-Gordon equations. Okay, so that's the goal of these pages. And since I'm presenting it in a situation of modified gravity, I want to start by reminding you that the equations in principle are fourth order, so you definitely need some sort of reduction. And the reduction will be done by introducing a conformal transformation, this G-DAG that I mentioned before. Right? So we will be using the metric G-DAG to get this reduction. G-DAG alpha beta will be f prime of r, depends on g times g alpha beta. So this is what we'll be doing here, and by doing that we will reduce the system from fourth order to third order. Okay, so we have one step down. And we will work in the so-called wave coordinate, so I already introduced that before. And this will not be sufficient, because in addition to that, we will do a so-called augmented formulation, not working only with a metric, but working also with the scalar curvature of the spacetime as an independent variable. And indeed, by doing that, we'll get what we want. We'll get a second-order system of nonlinear wave Klein-Gordon time. Okay. So that's the goal for this section. So let's move a little bit into this. First of all, the conformal formulation. So I just wrote here the expression of the gravitational curvature tensor of modified gravity. We have seen it a couple of times now, and it's also on the blackboard. N alpha beta is equal to 8 pi t alpha beta, and you have observed that it depends on the Hessian of the scalar curvature. Right. So the trick is how to get rid of the Hessian of the scalar curvature and keep only the box. Right. So box has also as many derivatives, but at least it's not as heavy. Conformal metric. So G DAG alpha beta is E2 rho. So E2 rho is indeed f prime of the scalar curvature. So E2 rho times G alpha beta, that's a conformal matrix that we use, right? So the exercise is clear. You take this and you rewrite this set of PDEs, not really PDEs, but this geometric equation under the conformal transformation. And so that's what we do now. To motivate, you know, why it should work, why something should happen, I'm writing here a general formula that you can check yourself. The scalar curvature, the Ricci curvature of the conformal matrix, the new matrix, which I call R DAG, is equal to the old Ricci curvature tensor plus or minus some corrections, right? Some additional terms. And these terms involve the Hessian of rho, but rho is essentially R. It involves box of rho, it involves also first derivatives of rho, right? Gradient rho, etc. Okay. So this is a general identity. Any metric, you do the conformal transformation with a rho, any rho, it doesn't have to be connected with a scalar curvature, any factor rho will produce this. And so you should see more or less, at least you can see there is a connection, right? This guy corresponds to this guy, and basically you hope to have chosen this one half properly. So this term here will be, or more precisely, that term here will be eliminated in the conformal transformation. Okay, so it's really not difficult, except that the calculations are a little bit complicated. So it's convenient to call f of r some function of rho, right? Rho is this guy. So it's really a change of variable. This is a change of variable. Maybe I wrote it here, sorry. So change of variable r gives rho is defined by this. And from the function f, what we do, we introduce the inverse of f, the Legendre transform. So this is very much related to the Legendre transform. So I'm not trying to elaborate what this this means, but just telling you that from functions of r, I can produce a number of functions of rho of this variable by some definition. It doesn't matter what they are exactly, but I call them w, 1, 2, and w of rho. Okay. So the precise form is somehow irrelevant for at this stage. And we do this, right? So we do the calculation. So I may just show the calculation and stop. So so this is a tensor n alpha beta that that we have. I compute the trace. I compute the Hessian of e to the power 2 rho. This is just a general formula. I compute the wave operator of this guy. I mean, these are really computations. So you can check that by yourself. You replace the quantities here. They were expressed in terms of r, but now I want to express everything in terms of rho. So I do this. And I recall the transformation of the Ricci curvature to eliminate the Hessian like we wanted, right? So just go through that, and you see that the miracle that we were hoping for is indeed taking place, and this is the final formula, okay? So the field equations of modified gravity in the so-called Einstein matrix, the GDAG, right, in this new metric, takes the following form. They contain the Ricci curvature on one side. On the other side, you have the matter tensor, T alpha beta. For some reason, I have subtracted the trace of T alpha beta taken with respect to the new metric GDAG. Okay, that's what I have done here. This is something you could have done also for the original Einstein equation. You can put this trace term either on the Ricci side or on the matter side. So that's somehow irrelevant. What is important is to take the trace with respect to the new metric if you want the formula to be correct. And now we have two more terms here. We have two terms. So one term which is of order zero with respect to the curvature, and we have one term which contains one derivative of the curvature. Right? So we have answered what I said in the beginning, a conformal transformation is actually leading you to a system which is now third order, just doing that. So if you work with GDAG, you are sure to have only up to three derivatives of the metric. Right? But that's not really very convenient. I mean, you that's not really what you want to do. So there will be more steps. And that's probably something I will show briefly next time. And next time we will, most part next time will be to start models with T2 symmetry. So all of that will be somehow revisited in a different way, right? So take this as a, you know, as a background, what I say today, is a background that you need to know at least roughly, as much as possible. And you can basically, we can basically start from next week by introducing the T2 symmetry, defining the curvature in a weak sense, and writing the Einstein equation in some coordinates. So you will see concretely what are the equations that you have to solve, that system of wave equations, etc. Okay, thank you.